Joe Brandl has worked for years honing his expertise of primitive bushcraft skills. His many years as a Boy Scout leader, vast experience as a hunter and wilderness adventurer, and his expertise in tanning animal hides have transformed him into a warehouse of knowledge and skills. In 1988, he began to operate a small tannery at the feet of the Wind River Range in Dubois, Wyoming. Since then, Absaroka Western Designs and Tannery has grown into a large tannery facility and showroom, producing Western decor for homes, lodges, and businesses. His love for outdoors guided him to attend the University of Nebraska, where he obtained a BS in Natural Resources and Wildlife Management. Joe's expertise also led him to the oldest participant to survive the 21-day challenge on Discovery Channel's Naked and Afraid. So from Dubois, Wyoming, welcome Joe Brandl.
Okay. Thanks. I'm not your typical speaker. I've never been typical in any way whatsoever. So I love outdoor survival. I love outdoor bushcraft, and it gave me a chance to be on Naked and Afraid, which was an amazing experience in itself. One of the most difficult things to do is to get a coal with two pieces of wood. Very, very few people can do this. A lot of cultures can. And there's a lot of mechanical ways to rub two pieces of wood together to get a coal, but it's rather difficult. And one of the things that I practice is how to do this on trying to start a fire, which we won't actually start a fire, but we'll be close, of just rubbing two sticks together. And what goes along this was one of my mantras that I picked up when I was in Africa, Naked and Afraid. And it's one thing that, a mantra that I carry with me day to day, and it's that when you fail, okay, it's not if you fail, it's when you fail, you want to fail forward, okay? And the reason for that is, you know, two of the greatest people that use that mantra, fail, fail forward, was probably Thomas Edison and the Wright brothers. You know, they figured out 1,000 ways on how to, not how to do it. And I knew that when we were in Africa, that we had to get a fire started. Now, fortunately, we had a fire striker going, and I knew that was pretty simple. So for me, I figured if I tested myself on some of the most difficult ways to get a fire going would be the hand drill. And I watched several people do this, and it was just magic. It's like, how can you spin your hands fast enough and hard enough in order to create the temperature high enough that you can get some sawdust to catch a coal? And it took me a long time to figure this out on how to do this. And people go, why would you do that? Just use a lighter. And I go, well, that's true. But I don't get the same sense of accomplishment as I do is when I'm rubbing two sticks together. And sometimes in the evenings when I'm in my shop, I'll find myself going upstairs, and what they call it is busting a coal. Can you bust a coal? And you have to rub this hard enough and long enough so that it'll create a temperature high enough to make a coal just like this. And the point of this is that this coal is your business idea. You've taken the simplest thing that you can of just two pieces of wood, and now you've got a coal, but you're a long ways from a fire, okay? So what you have to do is you have to come up with the other ideas that you start out with this coal as a business idea, and now you've got to have a business plan. You come up with all these different things. So what they would do in starting a fire, they take this small coal, and they'll dump this small coal into what's called a coal extender. This coal extender is just called mugwort. When it burns, it smells like pot, Not that I'm familiar with that. But that's what it smells like. And I was doing a cold the other night or so, and I'm carefully taking my hand. I'm not blowing hard on it. I'm just coaxing it into this coal to get some life into it, to try and get this mugwort burning. And of course, I'm getting it all over me. It's kind of a big, heavy smudge thing. And when my wife got home, she goes, God, have you been smoking pot? I go, no, I haven't smoked. She goes, you smell like pot. And we went out to eat. She goes, I think people are going to think you've been smoking pot because you smell like it. And so once you get this coal and you get the coal extender by using the mugwort here, it's going to make a bigger coal and grow into a bigger and bigger coal, but it's going to keep it, okay? At any time, this could go out. I could fail, and I could fail for a number of reasons. It could be my wood was too wet. I didn't have the right combination of woods. There are different types of woods that you use, one for the base, one for the spindle. You have to figure out what's that combination that's going to create that coal, because once I take this and it blows into a larger and larger coal, what it's going to do is get big enough that I can put it into a tinder bundle and I can blow onto it and provide the three things that fire needs, which is fuel and oxygen and heat. And those three combinations are going to give me a fire. When we were in Africa, it was so cold at night, down in the lower 40s, that we were freezing to get just to stay warm. And there wasn't enough firewood around that we could have two fires and sleep between them. So we ended up with just one fire, and of course we burnt our shelter down, which was, I thought it was totally her fault. She told me, she was a woman, she goes, I'm cold, put some more wood on the fire. I did, and it burnt the shelter down. So we lost our shelter on it. But you got to have fire, and a fire is going to bring you warmth, it's going to bring you comfort, it's going to bring you ability to cook food and to boil water. Okay, what's the point of all this? All that has to do with business. I started out in Nebraska, just a farm kid, you know, working there. Spent a lot of time outdoors hunting and trapping and fishing. But I grew up with great values. And those values, you're going to let people smell it, aren't you? Those values that I grew up with were not just given to me by my parents. My father died when I was 10 years old of health complications. And so I was mentored by my wrestling coach and my scoutmaster. So I have a lot of my passion in life are outdoors, wrestling, and scouting. And I just recently retired after about 30 years of being a scoutmaster, just because it was just time to let somebody else take over. But they're the one that mentored me, which meant they kicked my butt when I needed it. And so I learned value in the sense that, you know, to be good to people, to be respectful, and to be accountable. I went to school at the University of Nebraska, got a degree in wildlife, thinking I want to be a game warden, I want to be a biologist, I want to be a forest ranger. I want to do something I can help wildlife with. And after spending 5 long years in college, I can't believe I actually graduated. During that time, I had a choice to go either to Grants, New Mexico, or Wyoming. And you're going to find yourself, if you haven't already, you're going to find yourself coming to forks in the roads, okay? And you got to choose one way or the other. And you're going to make that choice. And you're never going to be able to change that choice once you do that. You can't go back in time, okay? You just can't go back. And I've always wondered, what if I'd have chose the other option? And I can wonder all I want, but it didn't make any difference. I'm who I am today because of those choices. And I chose to go to Wyoming. I started working summers for the Game and Fish Department, worked in habitat, lived in some great cabins in the outdoors. I ended up, once I graduated in 1984, I moved back out to Wyoming thinking I'm going to get a full-time job with the Game and Fish. I got to feed elk, 3 herds of elk up on the Grove Out Mountains with teams of horses. I had my first survival lesson in the sense I went over the snow machine, got it stuck. I didn't have any survival gear with me. I ended up spending the night out at sub-zero weather with my dog, with no matches, nothing to start a fire with. So I ended up cutting off my underwear. It was the only thing I didn't really need. I didn't have a knife with me, so I cut off my underwear, wrapped around a stick, stuck them in the gas tank, used a spark plug. to start the fire, and I had a fire all night. Ended up burning my bed by the time I was done because it was just so freezing cold, and the snow was deep, and I walked out 8.5 miles the next day, and after that, I've never not carried survival gear. Believe me, I have survival gear all the time with me. So if you're in a survival situation and you're with me and I die, check my pockets because I've got a lot of stuff in there. Once I got working for the Game and Fish Department, I kept thinking, I'm going to get a full-time job. I'm going to use my degree and I'm going to get a full-time job to do what I want to do. And I had a chance. I took the game warden exam while I was feeding elk. I took the biology exam, scored fairly well. And the more I thought about becoming a game warden, I thought, well, gee, if I'm a game warden, I got to be on the reservoir crew, and that's not going to be good. And so I didn't go that way. They didn't hire me. I don't know what happened. They never hired me. And in 1987, I was working over in Jackson Hole, working on habitat for the Game and Fish as a seasonal. So I was just working summers, and they said, well, we got enough money to keep you on till December, but after that, you're done. And here we were. My wife at the time, Jean, had gone through cancer. We had one son, Josh. And in 1985, she was diagnosed with Hodgkin's disease. And yet she was pregnant at the same time. And we had to make that choice because the doctor was saying, you need to have an abortion. And we said, no, we can't do that. That's not part of our faith. And so we're going to take chances. We're going to go ahead and do this. Josh was born premature. We had no money. I mean, we had no money. And so, well, we did have insurance, but even though it paid 80%, 20% of hundreds of thousands of dollars is a lot of money. And here I was, you know, making barely $830 a month. That's what I was making. I got a free cabin to live in, but that was it. And so we ended up moving over to Jackson, working for the Game and Fish. And December 31st, they said, that's your last day. I'd already lived in Dubois, Wyoming for a while, working for the Game and Fish. And so I called a buddy of mine over there, Lynn Stewart, and I said, Lynn, I need a job. I don't care what it is. I got a strong back and a weak mind, and I'll do anything you want. All my life, there was nothing I wouldn't do for a job. Nothing. There isn't any ditches I wouldn't have dug. There isn't any sewers I wouldn't have cleaned out. There was nothing I wouldn't have done for a job. And during that time, when we were going through these difficult times, I was working sometimes two jobs. Anything I could do to make ends meet, because it was more important that I support my family than what I was doing, even though it wasn't the dream that I had. I didn't even know what my dream was, except for I needed a job. So we moved back over to Dubois, Wyoming, and Lynn Stewart had a little tannery. It was about an 1,800-foot garage. It was much smaller than this whole room. And he had a little tannery there, and I started tanning hides for him. What I did is I shaved hides. You have to pull hides across the wheel, and it's a shaving job. And it's pretty mindless to do this job. And he paid me $5.25 an hour to do this job. And this was 1988. Fortunately, by the grace of God, Yellowstone burnt down. So when Yellowstone fires happened, they took all the surrounding satellite communities, and they decided that we needed help from that. So they hired me up at the airport after work, after 5:30. I went up, I was the airport manager, $10 an hour, okay? So that was great. So I'd work in the morning very early till late as I could, go up to the airport, sit in the airport till about 12:30, 1 o'clock, watching planes come in and helicopters and things, go back down, go to bed. At this time, we still had, you know, one son, and I just kept working that way. We worked in this little crappy tannery that had a wood stove in the middle. When you got 20 feet away, everything froze. It was crappy. But we worked so hard at it. And finally, when I was working there, Lynn decided he was going to go back to school. He said, you want to buy the business? And I said, well, yeah. I said, how much you need for it? He said, I want $35,000 for it, but I need $5,000 down. He could have been asking $35 million. We barely had ever $100 in our checking account. We had bills we had to pay. We paid doctors $10 a month, $15 a month, whatever we could. So what I did is I thought, well, okay, I'll just ask some people to give me some money. So I called a couple of relatives, and I said, I need $2,500 to pay down a down payment on this tannery. And they said, okay. So they wrote me a check, sent me $2,500, with no expectations of ever being paid back. So we took the $5,000, put it down on the tannery, ended up kept working the tannery that fall, and it kept growing and growing because we worked very, very hard at it. Late nights, my kids grew up with dead animals everywhere. They slept in grocery carts filled full of beavers and fox and coyotes and elk hides and stuff. That's where they slept at night, and they learned that's what our life was. And we kept trying to grow. I kept thinking, oh my God, I remember the first time when Lynn turned over the business and I tanned up like a dozen beaver hides and a guy wrote me a check for those. And it was, I don't know, $300 or $400. And that was my money that I did myself. And it inspired me to work harder. Because I thought, if I do 20 more, that's a lot more money. And if I do this and this and this, and I kept working, and we started going to rendezvous and different shows and selling all these different things. And at one time, I had all this great, grandiose idea about how can I expand the business. And a guy came through. I don't know how I met the guy. He's from Canada. He's a Canuck. And he said, you know what? He said, I got a business deal on rabbits. He said, we got all these rabbits up here, and the Indian people are tanning them, but they suck at it. He goes, can you do these rabbits? And I go, how many you got? He goes, 10,000. I go, sure. And I got the rabbits, and I go, these are really bad rabbits. And so I made a deal with them for like 20 cents a rabbit. So here I had this bundles of rabbits, 10,000 rabbits that were just nasty, tanned but nasty. So I decided, well, I'm going to take all these rabbits and make something out of them. So I started making bags and purses and dyeing them pink and purple and green and things like that. And then someone somehow, and I want to clarify this, is that I'm going to write a book someday called God Was My CEO. And it's going to be a bestseller because God was my CEO. I've been around religion all my life, and even though I'm not necessarily a religious man, I have great faith, okay? Always, always have faith. And somehow, somebody came through and said, I got some cheap labor for you. I go, where? He said, the prison system. I said, no kidding. He says, yeah. I said, down in Crawley, Colorado, they'll do stuff for you. I said, okay. So I contacted the prison system, the hobby shop. I said, I got all this rabbit skins, and I got little pieces of leather I was having tanned at Fox Valley Leathers in Salt Lake at the time. And Roger Marsh was an inmate. He was a murderer. I don't know who he killed, but he was. But a nice guy. Never met him in person, but he was a nice guy on the phone. He could have been Charles Manson. I didn't care. He was a good sower. So I said, well, I'm going to send you down some leather and some rabbit skins. He said, well, you can't send blue and red down because they're gang colors. I said, okay. He goes, you got to make sure you count all the needles and stuff. I go, okay. So nobody's making shanks out of things. And Roger would sew up these bags for me for like 15 to 20 cents. But Roger was an entrepreneur because what he would do is he would hire out other inmates in the prison at 2 and 3 cents a piece to do his work for him. And you think, God, why would they do it for that? It's because they got out of their cell to go to the hobby shop where they could make shanks if they needed them. So Roger, here I was an entrepreneur trying to figure out a business. Here was a guy in prison who was an entrepreneur that had the system down. And then as it worked out, you know, we kept working and working. Roger got transferred somewhere else to another prison, could take his sewing machines. I still have his sewing machines and all his patterns and stuff he made because I had to buy them all from him cheap because what was he going to do if I didn't buy them? So I ended up getting all this. Well, we started growing the business more and more and more because we worked so hard at it. And I was trying all these different things. Well, then in about 1994, now maybe 93, I was friends with the guys at Fox Valley, Bill Brown, Ron Roland, and Tony, great guys. And Bill said, hey, you know what? He said, there's an auction in New York. And I said, New York City? He goes, no, upper state New York. There's a tannery called 4-Year Leather, and they're going out of business, bad management, bad entrepreneurism. And so he said, they're going to have an auction. They're going to have all this equipment for sale. He said, you should go and buy some. I thought, well, hell, I ain't got any money. But that's all right. Doesn't matter. So I said, okay, that sounds great. So it's going to be an online auction. Just bid on it. I said, well, I don't know anything about online auctions. You know, and my first computer was a little tiny Mac about like this, and which I was excited to get at the time, but online wasn't such a thing then. And so finally things worked out. I thought, oh, dear God, how am I ever going to get this equipment? I mean, Bill said, you need to go out, fly, and look at it. I go, I don't have any money to fly out to New York to see this equipment. And the next couple of days, somebody walked in the tannery in the little office we had there and bought $400 or $500 worth of hides and leather. Just, I don't know why he came in, he did. I thought, well, hell, there's a plane ticket. So I got a plane ticket and I flew out to New York, and all the guys that were there in the tanneries there were all the workers, the blue collar guys that fixed everything, did stuff, and they were a skeleton crew of guys and they were beer drinkers. And I thought, well, I'll just buy these guys beer. So I'd buy some beer, and I would go there and hang out with these guys. They were playing cards, and all they were doing was watching the buildings. These buildings were huge, huge tanneries. You'd get lost in them, leather tanneries. And there was seven tanneries that this company owned, and there was five of them there in New York. I thought, well, that's great. So I made friends with all these guys by buying them beer, part of the barter system. And I came back home. I thought, oh, my gosh, there's so much stuff there, stuff I've never dreamed of having. How am I ever going to get any of that stuff? And so pretty soon they said, well, we're not going to do an online auction. We're going to go ahead and just have an auction. You got to come out and bid on it. I said, oh, my God, there's another plane ticket. So we worked hard. And lo and behold, somebody came in and bought enough stuff. And I had a plane ticket to go back to New York. So I went to New York, and I'm dressed. I look like Legends of the Fall. I got a big cowboy hat on, big, tall, black boots, vest and everything. And I look different than everybody else out there. And I'm walking around. I know I've made friends with all these guys, and they're telling me, Joe, don't buy that, buy that, don't buy that, buy that. And everything was like 5 and 10 cents on the dollar. And the two auctioneers were two Jewish guys from New York. Three-piece suits. I mean, they were just Jewish lawyers or auctioneers, and all they cared about was the bottom line. And here I am, this little guy walking around here, and there are people from India and China and South America and all of the United States who are multi-millionaire tanners. They own the largest tanneries in the country. And here I am walking around with these guys thinking, oh, my God, I don't belong here. But look at all this cool stuff. And they would come up to me, a couple of the old guys, and they would go, where are you from? I said, Dubois, Wyoming. Oh, God, I love Wyoming, hunting, you know, the whole thing. They said, so how many thousand hides do you do a year? And I go, one. He said, well, let me help you. He says, I was the same place you were years ago. He says, I'm going to help you out. And throughout that 3 days of auctions, which I was barely making, and before I could even go, I had to go to the bank and tell them I needed this equipment. Now, I didn't even have a tanner. I just had an 1,800-foot garage tannery. I didn't even have my new tannery yet. So here I was over there trying to buy equipment, hoping that if I bought this equipment, the bank would go, well, with all this equipment, we'll give you some money to build a new tannery. I was very optimistic at the time. So I was out there, and everybody took care of me. In fact, there were times when I would bid on a piece of equipment, and I didn't get it. I lost out on it. And one of the other guys from the big tannery would go, Joe, did you need that? I go, I did. They go, cancel my bid. And they dropped their bid and allowed me to buy it for $100. And this went on time and time again. Again, God was amazing. So now I got through all this auction, and the bank had loaned me $3,500 as a line of credit. I don't know why they did, because I didn't have any money. But they liked me. So now I had all this equipment, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, how am I going to get this equipment home? How am I going to get the equipment even out of these buildings? I didn't think quite that far ahead. Well, at some time during the auction, I had met some guys there, Irish Catholics, fit right in there in New York. And they said, I were bidding on stuff, I bought a whole pallet of these great big belts. And this big pallet of belts was sitting, and I paid $25, maybe $50 for that pallet of belts that run the big drums. And as we were going on there, Elvi, one of the Italian Catholic guys, he come back and said, Joe, did you buy those belts? I said, yeah, I did. He said, well, we need those belts because we bought the drums that's going to go to a tannery to tan alligators in Louisiana. We need to have those belts. What will you sell us to us for? And these guys have been so good to me. And I said, you know what, Elvi? I said, you can have them. You know, I said, I didn't pay much for them. He said, no, Joe. He said, I'll tell you what. He said, we'll trade you those belts. We got all this equipment here too. We'll take our crew. We'll take all your equipment out of here for you and load it onto trucks. And he goes, we'll trade you all that for those $50 worth of belts. I thought, oh, my God, that's amazing. How does this happen? So now I fly back home. I'm thinking, oh, my God, I got all this equipment coming. I think, what am I going to do with it? I have no building to put it in. So I went to the bank, and I said, I need to borrow $250,000. And they said, well, you got any collateral? I go, well, of course not. You know who I am. I don't have any collateral. And they said, well, you got to get an ordinance to build a tannery, because I'm out in the country, in town. And the town had an ordinance that said no tanneries, no blacksmith shops, no lumber yards, no cold storages, any of that stuff. And I said, well, you got all this other stuff, but I can't be in town. They said, no. They said, you have to change the ordinance. I said, oh, my God, I got to change the ordinance. And so I went to the town council and pleaded and begged. I just want to stay in town and do Dubois. Because when we first moved there in 1985, working for the Game and Fish, and when my first wife got cancer, there were people in town, this little town of Dubois, Wyoming, that raised so much money for us. We had to drive all the way to Salt Lake and then Pocatello to get treatments every week. We didn't even have the gas money to do it with. And there would be people that would come up to me and stick $20 in my pocket. I was a garbage man that winter in Dubois, I hauled garbage. I got a lot of cool stuff. Okay, I hauled home. But there wasn't a job that I wouldn't take. So I was a garbage man in Dubois. The lumber mill had just shut down. It was pretty depressed. And people constantly gave us money when we most needed it. I don't know why. They just did. Sometimes we needed just enough money to get to Pocatello or to Salt Lake. And people did that for us. And so I felt this commitment back to Dubois. I owe Dubois for what you did to me. And we had other options that we could have taken our tannery to and built it somewhere else. But for some reason, God decided we needed to have it in Dubois. So we did. And so I had to go to the town ordinance. They voted it down three times because a couple people didn't like my tannery idea. I mean, we went there with tears in our eyes saying, I just want to be here in Dubois. I just want to build a tannery. My kids want to grow up here in this town. We love this town. The people did so much for us. I want to give back to it. And finally, the bank said, we can't loan you any money until you get an ordinance passed. Finally, after months, we got an ordinance passed. The bank said, okay, you got to write a business plan. I thought, oh my God. I go, not a business plan. I don't know how to write a business plan. He said, well, you got to write one because we're going to get an SBA loan and that'll cover 80% of your loan. I said, well, that's great. So I went back home. I thought, I have no idea how to write a business plan whatsoever. I had the books, no idea. So what I did is I just told him my story. I said, here's who we are. And we're from Nebraska. And we're German. And we're hard workers. And we've never cheated anybody on a debt. We owe a lot of money to the doctors. We paid them off. We borrowed people $5,000. We paid them off. Because we promised, we put our word out to it that we'd do that. And the bank was made up of people who were loggers and ranchers that were hardworking people. And meanwhile, I'd been working in the community, helping out youth groups and the Chamber of Commerce and doing things, doing whatever I could to help out the community. And they said, you know what? We're going to help you out. So I wrote this business plan, which was just my life. I just said, here's who I am. Here's what I want to do. And I promise I will pay you back. And the SBA said that was the nicest business plan they've ever seen. I thought, well, that's pretty cool, but it's Wyoming. There's not a lot of business plans probably, but but they thought it was great. And I had a million ideas. I mean, I was a shotgun approach. I was going to not only tan hides, I was going to clean semi-truck tarps. I was going to clean saddle blankets. I was going to get me a cold storage. The store. I had a million ideas. I mean, I just puked it out there. And I wrote it all down. And it was grandiose. So I went to the bank and I said, well, here it is. And the SBA said, that's great. We're going to loan you 80% of the money. You got 20% you got to come up with. The bank said, you got 20%. I said, no, I don't have any money. I have no money. I owe everybody money. And the guy who wanted to build my tannery was a contractor named Gary Epp. And Gary's died here a few while back. Gary said, I believe in you. He said, I'll tell you what I do. I got a piece of property in town, and I'm going to give you that land and take a second mortgage on it. It's worth $40,000. That's the market value. You take that land, go to the bank, and use that as collateral. I go, okay, cool. So I went to the bank, and they said, you sure? I said, no, Gary said he's going to sign a second mortgage on it. So he did. Gary built my building, and as we were building the building, we thought, well, we had no place to live. I mean, we're going to have a huge mortgage on this tannery. Meanwhile, all this equipment was coming from New York, and I'm out there in the snow in the winter welding and trying to put all this stuff together, figuring out, now I'm going to have a building to put it in. And so I'm putting all this equipment together. The banks decide whether they're going to loan me the money. I got the 40% now, or the extra 20%. And we're working away. And Christmas Eve, we're sitting there in the store. And I don't have the back end done. It's a big wooden building in the front. And it's a metal building in the back where the tannery is. And I had it almost done. But I didn't have enough money to finish it. Because we'd put a basement apartment into it. Because we needed a place to live. And that cost like $30,000, $33,000. And so we're sitting there, we're staying in the store, and a friend of mine, John Worth, came by. And John Worth owns Woodworker Supply Catalog. The most analyst man I've ever met in my life. He's an engineer. So if you guys are engineers, so anal. But John's got a big heart. And John was a self-made entrepreneur. He started out selling tools in his garage, and now he's one of the largest woodworking companies in the United States. And he's a good friend of ours. And John came through Christmas Eve, and he said, during day, and he said, he goes, what are you doing? I said, we're staying in the store. And we had no money for Christmas, nothing. If it wasn't for grandparents, our kids would have gotten nothing. By then, I had two sons. And so I said, I'm out of money, and I can't finish the back of my tannery to finish the construction. I don't know what I'm going to do. He said, you need to go to the bank. You need to write a plan up. He said, you need to write a plan that says why you need that extra $30,000, because what you did with it was build yourself a place to live, which is better financially in the long run. You got to go to the bank and tell them your story. I said, oh my God. So I said, okay. So then John came back, cutting the Christmas tree, and he walked back in the shop there, and he said, you know what, Joey? He said, I've been thinking about this. He said, you go to the bank and do that. If they won't give you the money, I'll buy out the loan and I'll finance you. I thought, oh my God, you'd do that for me? He goes, yeah, absolutely, because I trust you. I believe in you and I trust you. I said, okay, so I went to the bank and I went to the president. He goes, are you out of your mind? He said, you're already borderline with $250,000 worth of money, and you want to borrow another $30,000? I go, yeah. He said, if I don't, I can't keep my business. And so he said, I'll go talk to the board. And the board said, well, hell, why not? We already gave him $250,000. We'll give him a couple more. So they gave me $30,000 more. And I went back and I said, okay, I got more money. And then I was so close to getting the building done, I couldn't afford to finish it. And I went to the contractor who gave me the land. I said, Gary, I can't afford to pay you anymore. I can't afford your percentage. I said, I don't know what I'm going to do. I said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. He said, I'm going to subtract my percentage off. You hire my guys at their wage. You can have all my tools. I'll take myself and play the picture and never take another dime from you. That was the only way we finished that building. So then we finished the building, moved all the equipment in, and we started up rocking and rolling. I mean, we were doing really well. We had a lot of homes in Jackson. We were doing furniture. Don't you hate that happens? It's not my mom, so it's okay. This is my first phone that I've had like this. And when I first got it, I dressed it up because I thought it was really funny. And here you go, honey. I can't even read it. I made a selfie stick with a plunger on my head. And if you go to my Facebook account, you'll see all the creative ideas I did with selfie sticks. But the first one was a plunger on my head with a selfie stick. So now we're going great guns, and we're doing really well in the business, and we have a lot of clients in Jackson, and they're buying a lot of furniture, and we're doing well. So we buy some land outside of town because my wife decided that she can't live in the basement anymore. We need to buy some land and a house. So we did that, went back in debt again. And so we lived there for a while, and things started deteriorating, got worse and worse. Ended up getting a divorce back in 2007. And during that time, too, the recession hit, and everybody with all these multi-million-dollar homes wasn't buying stuff anymore. And during that time, I decided that, I had a lot of hides for tanning. We had 5-6 employees. Things were going good. Pretty soon, people just started doing other things, and I was getting less and less people. I had to decide, what was I going to do? A lot of people were complaining that, oh, my God, business is down, tourism down. I got to quit my business. I didn't think that way. What I thought, okay, what am I going to do now? Well, during this time, I was doing reenactments, dressing up in clothing, and going to these different events, selling my goods. And then I got connected with people that said, hey, can you do movie costumes? Can you do Western? I go, yeah, absolutely I can. I can make anything. I lied, but I can make anything. And so I connected with these people, and they said, we need 150 pair of moccasins for a movie. I said, I can do it. So after I got done tanning hides, what I did is I sewed moccasins. Then pretty soon I got to be more clothing. Then I got to be on a movie set as an assistant costumer, and I was making more principal costumes, and they were paying me ridiculous prices for this stuff, renting it. So I got it back, and I sold it again. And this kept going on and on. I thought, oh, this is so cool. And then I got to do some public speaking things, and people were paying me to stand up here and tell them my story. I thought, oh, my God, that's so cool. Can you believe that? And so I kept thinking about all the different ideas that I could do to make my business work, because if one thing wasn't working, you had to come up with something else. So far, what I've tried to do is I do teepees. I set up teepees for people. Paint teepees, set up teepees, take down teepees. I'm the teepee guy in Dubois. I do costumes for Western films and movies, not quite as much, but I do that. But I also made stuff for movies or for museums and other projects. I made clothing, buffalo coats and things for people. A few years ago, I ended up getting into rawhide. Because I thought, well, I can make rawhide because that's easy. Right now I'm tanning hide with the hair on, but if I can just let the hair slip off, I can make rawhide. There weren't very many rawhide tanneries. So I called a guy in Havre, Montana that said, yeah, I'm going to sell my tanner. I'm going to retire. I said, well, how much you want for it? I said, well, I don't know. He said, oh, let me look, check the prices. So I went to the bank. We'd had a pretty decent year. And I said, I need to borrow $30,000. I'm going to refinance my loan. Because after I got a divorce, I took on all the debt and my mortgage went back up another $100,000. So I thought, oh shit, I'm back in debt, you know, and I owe people so much money. But I did, I worked hard, and I went back to the bank and I said, I need $30,000 added onto my loan because I'm going to buy this rawhide equipment up in Havre, Montana. So I got back home and I called Larry up there and I said, Larry, I said, I got $30,000. I'm going to buy your equipment. He said, Joe, that $30,000 won't even buy the fleshing machine. He said, that's $45,000. I thought, oh my God, what am I going to do now? I got all this big plan. I'm going to make rawhide. And the next day, a guy walked in my shop, Rod Johnson, and he needed a piece made for his horse. He had a horse that had an injury, and he needed some raw. He needed something. And come up with an idea to help his crippled horse. So I showed him what he needed. We're sitting there talking. I said, you know, Rod, I said, I have. He goes, well, how are things going? I said, well, I have this idea that I can buy this rawhide equipment and make a lot of money. I said, but the guy needs $80,000 for everything that I want to get. I said, I can get $30,000 from the bank, but I don't know what I'm going to do. My son said that he can probably get a military, you know, loan and loan me the money. I said, but I don't want to put him through that. Rod said, you need $50,000? I said, yeah. He said, I got $50,000. He said, I'll just write you a check. And I said, well, are you serious? He goes, well, yeah, why not? He said, I trust you. And we shook hands on it. He said, we probably ought to get some paperwork, because I'm getting older. And he said, I might die on it. My sons need to know what's going on here. And in a couple days, he wrote me a check for $50,000. And I just gave him the same interest I was paying on my loan, just because of who I was and what I stood for and the work that I did. And I was just brought to tears. I couldn't believe people kept doing this for me. Why would they do it for me? And I know why. And it's because I worked hard. I had integrity. I had responsibility. I had accountability. And my handshake was as good as gold. I've always believed that. And so I bought all this tanning equipment, brought it all down to Dubois again, made several trips up there. And right now I'm the largest rawhide producer of wild game in the United States. Well, maybe of deer and elk. And then I thought, what am I going to do with all of it, all these other small? So I started making pet chews. So I'm the only person in the United States that makes rawhide pet chews out of wild game. And it's all organic because I only use food grade lime and vinegar to neutralize it. So if you need dog chews, I'm the guy you want to see. But the problem is that I'm working so hard day to day just with the operation. I don't have any more employees. Okay, I'm working by myself. Same size building. I have kids that come in. Oh my gosh, these kids. They're the millennium group. So, but these kids come into me because they need work experience. And everybody just sends them to me. I asked God a long time ago for patience, and he sent me these kids. And they are absolutely dumb. They are dumb as rocks. And I was not a patient man in my 20s and 30s and even early 40s. But I'm telling you right now, nothing fazes me. These kids come in and they're part of what's called a SOAR group. They're from all over the United States. They usually come from pretty wealthy families and they don't know a dang thing. They don't know hot water, cold water. Okay? They don't know righty, tighty, lefty, loosey. They don't know anything. And I've got hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of equipment and a lot of sharp knives in there. What the hell, I got insurance? So they come down here, and one kid's named William. And William is from New York City. And he's all his life, he's 19, 20 years old, and he's lived on like the 15th floor of this apartment. The kid has done nothing in his life remotely related to anything I've ever thought of. He's never had to wash dishes. He's never cooked a meal. He's never done anything. Always gone to private schools, but he's got some issues. So his parents send him out to this school, and they teach kids leadership stuff, the SOAR school. It's a great program. So they send him and Daniel down to me. Oh, my gosh, you have no idea. But Daniel is one of the hardest working kids I've ever had. He loves doing crappy work. And so That's my yodel. That's the only one I can hear. I'm kind of tone deaf. It's the only one I can hear. I don't know how to turn it off. So anyway, these kids work so hard. In fact, because of my work ethics that I've done, I have parents send their kids to me for boot camp. And they don't get any electronics. And they cry a lot. And I'm not very sympathetic to kids. I mean, I've had some 8-9-year-olds all the way up to 15, 16-year-olds. I go, yeah, they can just come live with me. All of this has helped me develop my business. I'll never be rich. I'll never have a great retirement. I love what I do because it gives me such satisfaction of taking something that's so simple as just a raw hide, a nasty hide, and I turn it into this beautiful project when I finish it. And I've never not appreciated a beautiful, soft buffalo hide. And along the way, some of the things that I've learned, number one, the first one was fail forward. Okay, no matter what, when you fail, and you will fail, you fail forward. When I went to Africa for Naked and Afraid, that was a great opportunity, and I was so lucky to get it. I mean, I was the oldest one to do it. I had a cute partner, and I lost a lot of weight. It was a good diet plan. But when I got to go there, I got a free camping trip to Africa, and I was the oldest guy to do it. And here I had this 29-year-old lesbian with me. I didn't know that for about 5 days. And it's called the darkest hour when you see it. But on the other hand, you know, here, I come right out in the open. I go, I'm conservative, Republican, Catholic. Hope my partner's the same. Liberal, Democrat, gay, small, young. But we met each other, great big hug. And we got along so well because we both knew that no matter what happened to us, there were people in the world that were surviving every day with a place to live, a job, no arms or legs, very, very difficult things. Now, all we had to do is survive 21 days. My ex-wife at the time, we stayed very connected because of the two boys, was dying of heart failure because of the cancer treatment that she got in 1985. It destroyed her heart and her lungs. So I was with my boys just before I left, and I said, don't worry, things will be okay. Look, things are looking good. And I said, no matter what happens with your mom, you guys have to really be close together. She was back in Nebraska at the time. And so I was confident that when I got back, things were going to be okay. And during that time, on April 23rd, she died. And so it was very difficult for my boys to deal with this because I should have been there. And I felt huge, huge guilt. And they didn't tell me this, but my producer called Mary Ellen, my wife here tonight, and said, how's Jean doing? She goes, well, she died yesterday. And they said, well, can we tell Joe and film his reaction? And she said, no, the boys said, don't do that. So I didn't know this. And meanwhile, I'm out there trying to find something to eat, food. And believe me, you know, a lot of shows are staged, a lot of it's crap. But I'll tell you from my heart that everything we did, we earned it. I would have nothing less. You know, I wasn't going to take any handouts. They didn't script anything to me. Probably why I'm never going to get on XL because I don't do drama. I was there to survive, to help my partner. She had post-traumatic stress. Her mother's Mormon. Her dad's Mexican Catholic. I mean, she had all the bats against her trying to grow up as this gal in Moab, Utah, being gay. And she's an amazing, amazing person. I just love her to death. And she'd never been with a naked guy in her life, ever. And we were spooning together at night. It was not comfortable for her. It's all about survival, I kept saying. It's all about survival. So anyway, look how happy she is. Actually, she's going, oh, God, I'm going home. So she hated being naked, too. She spent more time on clothes than getting food. My job was to get food. Her job was to make her a new outfit. She owned 86 pair of shoes. And the sandals I made her, she goes, oh, this is pair 87. And so, yeah, 87 pair of shoes she has now. And every day when we were there, we first had to get the fire started, and she had this crappy little fire starter that her grandpa gave her. And when she pulled it out, I thought, oh, no. Because I had my knife. Now, not too many people know this, but hidden in my knife handle, they don't know this today in Discovery, I had an extra fire steel fish hooks and fishing line hidden in my handle. Let's not let it go outside this room here, okay? Just in case things didn't work, I was going to make sure I had extra stuff in my knife handle. So I lied to him when I got there about my knife. I said, you know, this knife was my father's. It's the only thing I got from him. They go, oh, God, you should get that knife. I go, yes. I made the knife myself. So it was a white lie, but I got my knife. She got this crappy little fire starter, and she's trying to start the fire, and I'm doing my best to make sure that I get the finest tinder to get this fire going. She's okay at skills, but she's not great. But it didn't matter. I just wanted someone with a great attitude. So meanwhile, she's throwing sparks on this, and it ain't going right. And I said, well, let me, you know, she goes, I can't do it. She goes, I got to quit. I go, no, fail forward. I just got to get better tinder. And finally, she got a spark. We got the fire going. She's throwing big chunks of wood on. I'm trying to take them off. Thinking to myself, do not say anything. Because if you say it on camera, you own it. And they will make you a villain to this sweet little Mexican gal. And so I didn't say anything. I just kept putting little pieces of wood on. And we finally got the fire going. It was all great. Hoorah. She wanted a chest bump, and I said no. So anyway, now we got to get food. Our first food are two grubs. They were grubalicious. She didn't really like them that well, but she got those. And then for the next 12 days, we ate grubs and minnows and snails and all of it, all the food for both of us in 12 days. If you masticated it up, wouldn't have filled this bottle in 12 days. Okay, that's how little food. But you don't need much food. You need water, lots of water. And we had a pot, so we were able to boil water in it. And I built these really cool traps, these Arapuka bird traps, and they're so cool. But on 13th day, we finally caught one of the birds. And it was like the greatest bird of my life. And I tried to explain it. I said, well, how'd you feel about the bird? And the camera crew was gone. They'd already left for the night. So it was just Andrea and I. And so when I went over and I saw this bird, it's like, oh, my God, this is so great. And she didn't like killing things, even though she owns a lot of guns. She was a police officer, and she owns a lot of guns. Just got a new pink Beretta. She doesn't like killing things. So I had no problem popping that bird's head off. Pop, you know, no problem at all. But she's happy about the bird. And we cooked the bird that night. And it was the best, most delicious bird I've ever had in my life. And they asked me the next day, they go, what was it like killing that bird? And I tried to explain to them, if you guys are hunters, you guys and gals that hunt, if you remember the first time you ever killed your first duck, your first deer, your first goose, whatever it was, there'll never be another first. There's only one first, okay? So that's what it was like, and it was emotional. And so for me, but meanwhile, when they interviewed, I kept saying, nope, cowboy up, I'm tough, cowboy up. But there were several emotional parts. One was the bird. The second one, she came out and said, I've always felt worthless all my life. And I always felt bad because, you know, who I was. And she tried to kill herself. She had cuts on her wrist. And one of the coolest things was that one of my mantras has always been, when I've been through really difficult times in my life, is to just breathe. You know, and when I got to the airport, the little African gal that picked me up had tattooed on her arm, just breathe. I go, oh my God. I go, that's mine. She goes, oh yeah. She goes, I was in the drugs and alcohol, and I wrote that on my arm to remind me when things get tough, you just got to breathe. And when I got to Andrea, she had a lot of tattoos, you know. And so on her wrist in white across her scars was just breathe. I go, oh my God, that's cool. So that was a great connection for us, and we kicked butt. We did a lot of really cool things, built this cool raft. When I got out the last day, we went back to the lodge, and I got on the internet. It was really spotty because we were way out in the boonies, and they had generators. And I saw an email from my son that said Mom had died. And man, I just burst into tears. I was so upset because I thought, why couldn't you wait? Why couldn't you just wait till I got home? And I felt so bad that I wasn't there for my boys. Here I had just accomplished one of the most amazing things that I thought in my life, that I got to survive naked in Africa, on my own with a partner to help her out, with minimal gear, and I kicked butt. Man, I kicked butt. And I had this personal trophy of mine on my imaginary shelf that said, look what I did. And all of that was nothing, because now I had to go home to my two boys and try and explain to them why I wasn't there when their mother died. And that was so difficult for me. And so the plane ride home was really tough. And when I got home, I realized several things. You know, one thing was the fail forward got me through it. I think that was really important. But what I learned most importantly was that pay attention to the details in life. All the things that I kind of took for granted, I call them gifts from God, I think. The details I had to pay attention to out in Africa during this show was like how the birds behaved every day, where the food was, where the water was. Your senses become so enhanced when you're out there with nothing. You know, your sense of taste and smell. We could smell people when they came towards it. And so I learned when I got home, humbled, that not only did I fail forward, I had to pay attention to the details in life. Okay, that was so important to me. And I do. When I see something amazing, whether it's a rainbow, whether it's cloud, whatever it is, sometimes when you meet people, you know, I was talking to the students here before this, and I said, you know, I don't know how positive, negative energy works. I just know that it does. I know that when you have a lot of positive energy and you go to someone who's in trouble and you give them that great big hug, that there's a transfer of energy. I don't know how it works. I don't care how it works. I just know that it does. And I told the students in the, you know, at the dinner table and a little earlier today that you got to be positive. And Andrea told me what got her through after the suicide and all the other stuff. She goes, Joe, if you think positive, positive things happen. And it did. We thought positive every day. And we only caught one bird. We caught four birds. And we caught a huge catfish. And I found a marula tree with lots of fruit. And everything was so positive. And I vowed to myself after being with this person, and she just unloaded on me all her difficulties, and her tears were just flowing. In fact, it was a huge hug by all the camera crew. They were just bawling because of the emotion that was with this, of her telling her story. And when I got home and I kept thinking about the details in life, I go, that's so true. You really have to pay attention to the details in life. And just like my story about my business, how people came into my life and gave me things I never expected. I just never expected that you would be so good to me. Why would you do that for me? And I think, again, it's because of who I was, the presence that I had, and I tried to be good, and I tried to be positive, and I'm far from perfect. So I paid a lot of attention to the details when I got home. And lastly, one of the things I learned is that focus on the things you can control in life. You know, I was just like you guys, probably dumber, but if I was going to college, but I worried all the time about, oh my God, I got a test coming up. I got a mortgage I got to pay. I got all this stuff. I got next week this might happen and this might happen. And if this happens, I got to do this. And I worried and I stressed all the time. And it's such a waste of time. So I learned that when you get up in the morning, focus on what you can control at this moment. So whether it's tonight, when you leave here, and what you do for your actions, when you leave here, the people that you see, the people that you're going to greet, when you get up in the morning and you go to class, and you go to work and you meet people, you control your actions. Nobody else does. Never let anyone define who you are as a person. And that's one of the best things I ever did for myself, because despite all the financial burdens that I've gone through, I still go through, I still worry about, you know, am I going to get my business sold? What's my life going to be like? Is this going to happen? Am I going to get another show? You know, all these things I worried about, now I get up in the morning and I think, okay, what can I control today? If I need money to pay a bill, it means I have to get up and work. It means I have to do the work so that the money comes in. God does not drop you a check off in the mail. I guarantee you, I've asked for it 100 times. Doesn't work, okay? You need three things to survive, okay? Number one, you need a good head. You need a good pair of hands, because whatever you do, you got to work with your hands. And you need a good knife. Remember that. Get a good knife. And you can do anything that you can think of. Some of the questions, you know, I got today when I was here is, what was the most difficult thing in Naked and Afraid, and what was the best thing? And the best thing was catching the first bird, and the most difficult thing was freezing. It was so difficult, cold, things like that. But when I got home, my relationship with Mary Ellen was different. My two sons, I didn't see them for probably another 2 or 3 weeks. And I knew that I did not have any control over being there. I'd already signed up for this. I couldn't change it. I didn't want to change it. I thought things were going to work out for the best, you know, while I was gone. And it ended up being that way. My sons had to stand on their own 2 feet. They had to count on each other to get over the grief of their mother dying. My family that was back there in Lincoln stepped up to the plate. And I have 8 brothers and sisters. So we're like Catholic Mormon combined, that many kids. And they stepped up to the plate and helped the boys all the way through it too. And it was exactly what needed to happen. And I had no control over that whatsoever. And I'm at peace with that. I'm okay with that. And so for me, it's a matter of being at peace with yourself, working hard. You know, Mike says it the best, you know, love what you do. And, you know, one of the things, I just learned this quote the other day. This is so cool. And it has a lot to do with businesses, is that I saw this quote the other day about an apple. And it's easy to count the seeds in an apple. We can take this apart, we can count every seed in there. We know for sure how many seeds are in this apple. But none of us know how many apples are in a seed. And your businesses are the same way. You can lay everything you have out on the table. You can count it all out and you can figure everything that you have. And you know that for a fact. But nobody knows what the potential of your business can be and who you are. A couple of the other pieces of advice to close with. John Worth again told me a couple of things for you guys that are going to run businesses. Number one, this is great advice. When you do a good job, you produce a good product, okay, to a customer, they will tell 13 people that you did a great job. And if you do a crappy job, if you say that's just good enough and you push your product out the door, 13 people, that one person is going to tell 13 people what a crappy product you had. And it's just going to keep going. The second best advice I got as an entrepreneur was when someone calls you up and they're angry at you because they didn't like your product, your service, or something about you, okay, listen. Let them blow it off for 5-10 minutes. Then don't offer them anything. Don't offer them, because right away we're ready to apologize, give them the world. John said, what you do is you say, what can I do to make it right with you? And 9.5 out of 10 times, they will ask for less than what you would have offered, because all they want is to know that you cared about them. And I practice that all the time now. I don't BS. When I screw up, I tell them, look, of course, I'm at the age now, I can go brain fart. Not my fault. And so I just tell them, I go, I'm sorry, I screwed up. I will make it my personal agenda to take care of you the next time. And I've never lost a customer because of that. So I think that's important. So thank you very much. I really appreciate the audience, the time. If you have questions, you can ask me anything. Well, almost anything.
Does anyone have any questions for Joe?
It's a quick question. You gonna eat that apple?
I'll give you half of it. Okay.
Thank you.
I did spit on my hands before I did that bow drill, though, so just. That's all right.
I'm just curious how you got on Naked Afraid. Did you submit yourself? Did they find you because you're a cool guy? Or How'd you get on that show?
Nobody knew I was that cool. I watched the shows, all the different survival shows, and I thought, these people are idiots. They don't know what they're doing. And so I applied, and I gave them this crazy story about who I am. I told them my Boy Scouts were the toughest ass troop in the United States, and they are. And I started in September, and I didn't know until December. They flew me out to L.A. Oh, my God, they flew me out to L.A. Talk about a country mouse in the city to interview, because they want to know what you're like. And so I'm out in L.A., and they take me to a hotel where I'm going to be interviewed. I got my cowboy boots on, my cowboy hat, and I got this duffel bag. And this is, I think it's really funny. And so I'm squatting down watching people with my back to the wall. And there are the strangest people in California I've ever seen. I was really amazed when I got to Logan here and I went to Smith. I'm going, oh my God, look at all these weird people. Look at how they're dressed. Because I don't get out of town very much. And as a hunter, you guys know a buck from a doe when you glass them, don't you? How they walk. I mean, you know the difference. You can see right off. So I'm up against the wall there watching people in this hotel in L.A. And I'm watching this woman walk towards me. I'm thinking, that's a buck. I thought, man, it's dressed like a doe. And I'm just thinking, oh, my gosh. And sure enough, it was a buck in doe's clothing. And I kept asking myself, should I be here? So I went through all the interviews, and it took a long time, and they finally called me back, and they said, guess what? You're in, you're going to go, and you're going to Africa. And I'm thinking, yes. And at the same time, I was interviewing for a show called Migrations. It was on National Geographic, of these 20 people that follow it's just a starvation march is all it was. And they follow the wildebeest across Africa, and several of my friends ended up getting on that. And I've never applied for a show in my life. I never always thought it'd be cool to do a television show like the Red Green Show or something like that. But I thought, okay, and now I had a chance to do two shows. They were going to fly me to New York for the final interview for Migrations, and hopefully I was going to get on. There's a good chance I was going to. And then all of a sudden, Naked and Afraid called and said, you're going to Africa. And I thought, oh my God, that's so crazy. So I just applied. I got really lucky. There are thousands of applicants. I've applied to Alone. I've applied to all the other survival shows. But I'm so screwed by this contract from Discovery because I don't get out of it till May, and you can't do anything else. It's a lawyer contract, and it was written by LA lawyers. And when I got the contract, I sent it to two lawyer friends of mine, and I said, what do you think of this? They go, you'd be an idiot to sign this. They go, but you're perfect for the show. I said, okay, so I signed it and sent it off. So anyway, but who knows where I'll go from there? I have no idea. Here's another great quote. Expectations are the seed of unhappiness. Do not have expectations. I guarantee you, you're going to be disappointed. Have hope, lots of hope, but never have expectation. So I have no expectations at all in life anymore. I have great hope, though. Is that it? Ready for ice cream?
All right, Joe. Well, we just wanted to share a little bit of Cache Valley with you.
All right.
Because you shared a little bit of Wyoming. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, let's get
Thank you guys very much. I appreciate it.